But if you got Bibles, let's get into the Word this morning. If you are new with us, you'll discover today that we study through God's Word. We believe it's powerful, and so we just teach it verse by verse, line by line. And here this morning, where we left off last Sunday, we're at Luke chapter 18, verse 18. And here's what we read. A certain ruler asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't steal. Don't give false testimony. Honor your father and mother. All of these I have kept since I was a boy," the rich ruler said. And when Jesus heard this, he said to him, "You still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me," he said to this man. When he, the rich ruler, heard this, he became very sad, Luke tells us, because he was a man of great, what does it say? Wealth. This guy was loaded. He was rich. And so Jesus looked at him and said, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. Indeed, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." Those who heard this asked, "Who then can be saved?" Remember, the original question was, "What must I do to inherit eternal life? What should I do?" And so he kind of answers all this and talks about all of this, and people around said, "Well, then who then can be saved?" Jesus replied, "What is impossible with men is possible with God." Peter, one of the disciples, said to him, "We've left all we had to follow you." "I tell you the truth," Jesus said to them, "no one who has left home or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail to receive many times as much in this age and in the age to come, eternal life." Father, today as we look at your word, we do ask that you would show us how this applies. Help us to understand the truth that's in it, but more importantly for us is how that truth should affect and change our life. And so we just pray that your spirit would give us eyes to see. And it's in Jesus' name. And everybody said, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" It's one of the most important questions anybody ever asks. In fact, this interchange we see right here, this exchange that Jesus had, is one of the most famous of all the interactions that Jesus had with people, because the question was so genuine and the question was so important and the response of Jesus was so powerful and so provocative. It's something that we all probably have heard about before. The rich, some people say young, it's not in there, but the rich ruler. His question, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" just as important then as it is today. You know, as a pastor, and I'm sure this is true for you as well, all of the funerals that I've ever done, and in 20 years of doing ministry, I've done probably more than I would like to say, a lot of funerals. And the truth is, I have never met somebody, a family, that wanted to consider or think that their loved one wasn't in a better place, or for those that were of faith, wasn't in heaven. I mean, I have never sat down and talked with the family and said, "Well, we really hope that he's burning in hell." I mean, that just never gets said. And you hear about people whose loved ones die or their animals die, and everybody always wants to believe, "Well, Fifi went to heaven," right? I mean, because that's in all of us, this afterlife. How do we get here? What happens when we die? And you know, death, it bats 1,000 for all of us, doesn't it? There's nobody who doesn't die. And so I want to read to you some beliefs about the afterlife, about, as he asks, eternal life. And I want to share with you how some of these religions in our world today believe that you get there. Do they believe there's a heaven? And how do you get there? First of all, the most populous of religions in the world today, with 2.3 billion followers. There's about 7.6 billion people on the earth today, give or take a couple million, right? And so Christianity comprises 2.3 billion of the population. And of course, we know as Christians that we believe there is a heaven, don't we? We believe there's a better place that we're going to. Jesus spoke often about heaven and, for that matter, hell. But there's two different branches of Christianity. There's the Protestant branch and there is the Catholic branch. Catholics believe that you are saved by faith in Jesus plus good works. You remember back in 1517 when Martin Luther pinned those 95 theses to the door of the Wittenberg Church? You remember that out of that, the upshot, of course, was the Protestant Reformation, but it was also those statements, sola gratia, sola scriptura, and sola fide, which means grace alone, scripture alone, and faith alone. And so as Protestants, we don't believe it's faith plus works. We believe it's faith or grace alone is how we're saved. Amen? So yes, we believe in a heaven as Christians, and two different branches of it believe how you get there a little differently. Second, the second largest religion in the world, anybody? Islam. Islam has 1.6 billion followers. Muslims, who are the adherents of Islam, Muslims believe, listen to their belief about heaven and how to get there. That's the guy's question. Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? So Muslims, 1.6 billion, believe salvation comes to those who obey Allah sufficiently and that good works outweigh the bad. Muslims hope that repeating what Muhammad did and said will be enough to get to heaven. But they also recite extra prayers, they fast, they go on pilgrimages, and perform good works in hope of tipping the scales, obviously in the right direction. And then, for a Muslim, martyrdom in service to Allah is the only work that is guaranteed to send a worshiper to paradise, along with the 70 virgins that are waiting there, right? That's what they believe. Hinduism, the third largest religion in the world with 1 billion followers. Salvation for them, or moksha, as they call it. This is going to be, if you'd like, because there's six of these that I'm going to look at, and they're quick, but this will be on our website. My notes will be there. So if you'd like to be able to read these and study these further along afterwards, you can. Don't feel like you got to write it all down. Hinduism, 1 billion followers. Moksha, salvation. They do believe in it, is reached when the worshiper is freed from the cycle of reincarnation and his or her spirit becomes one with God. One becomes free by ridding oneself of bad karma, as I'm sure you've heard. This, ridding yourself of bad karma, can be done in three different ways in Hinduism. Through selfless devotion to and service of a particular god, through understanding the nature of the universe, good luck with that one, or by mastering the actions needed to fully appease the gods. Again, works-based. What you're going to see is in these top six religions in the world, Christianity is the only one, Protestant Christians, that believe that we're saved by grace in Jesus Christ alone. No good works. Every other one, as I'm going to continue, is about doing good things. Buddhism, fourth largest in the world. 400 million followers in Buddhism. Their heaven is called Nirvana, and it's to be a rejoining of a spirit, your spirit, with God. And reaching Nirvana in this religion, Buddhism, which is a transcendental, blissful, spiritual state, requires following the Eightfold Path. I'm not going to go into the Eightfold Path. It's a bunch of things you're supposed to do. I'm just stating heaven, as far as these are concerned, and how to get there. Sikhism is the fifth largest with 30 million followers. Quite a drop right there. Salvation in Sikhism is attained by living an honest life and meditating on God. If good works are performed sufficiently, the worshiper is released from the cycle of reincarnation and becomes one with God. And then Judaism is the sixth largest religion with 20 million followers. Dropped way down. Heaven for Jews is reached today, for Judaism, is reached by following the law, which includes the sacrificial system. But you'll know that there's no longer a temple in Jerusalem. We're going to go up on the Temple Mount for those of us going to Israel next April. There is no longer a temple. There are no longer priests. There is no longer the sacrificial system. So in place of that sacrificial system is now prayer. And so that's what they do. They pray, which is why when we go to Israel and we go to Jerusalem, you'll see all these Hasidic Jews, very religious Jews, going to the prayer wall and praying, because that's the replacement at the base of the temple that they have now to reach heaven, following the law and prayer in place of the defunct sacrificial system. Those are the top six religions in the world. Christianity, distinct in that we as Protestants don't believe good works are required or any works are required. We believe the work of Jesus Christ was sufficient. Amen? Now, you also have the views of atheists, because atheists makes up a large portion of our population today. And as we know, atheists believe, one, there is no God, and they also believe that there is no heaven commensurately or hell, and so it doesn't matter what you do in this life, because there is no afterlife. All it is just one eternal dirt nap. You lived 70 years or 80 years or 90 years. Good job. Enjoyed it, because now all you're going to do is sleep eternally. There's other ones that are less Confucianism. They believe the afterlife is unknowable. So just do good in case you happen to make it there. Why do I say all that? Because, again, the question back then, just as it is today, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And if there's one person that the people in that day wanted to hear the answer from, it was this amazing rabbi, this amazing miracle-working teacher, this man who had crowds following him bigger than any other person or crowd. He had people that wanted to hear what he had to say, and he was teaching about God in ways that no other religion and no other religious leader was teaching. And so they wanted to know, this man did, hey, what must I do, according to you, to inherit eternal life? And so he starts off by saying, good teacher. And right away, notice, Jesus takes issue with the way he approached the question. Why do you call me good? Jesus says, no one is good except for God. Not to say that Jesus wasn't good, but more so to say, do you believe that I'm God if you're calling me a good teacher? Because only God is good. And so the man goes on, and Jesus really goes to what he already knew. Jesus goes to what he already believed about how to get to heaven, and he goes to what he already followed. He went to the commandments. Jesus says, you know the commandments. Now, as Jesus quotes the commandments, he only quotes 5 out of the 10 known as the 10 commandments, right? But do you realize the 10 commandments in the Bible, Exodus chapter 20, are never called the 10 commandments? We call them the 10 commandments because the reality is they were the beginning 10 of 613 commandments that God gave. We don't call them the 613 commandments. But Jesus, in this case, he quotes off 5 to start with. Now, I want you to realize the 613 commandments that God gave Moses and Moses gave to the people, all of this is found in the book of Leviticus and the book of Deuteronomy, which is a retelling. So when's the last time any of you read Leviticus or Deuteronomy? Hopefully, maybe you have recently. If not, all of that contains these 613 laws. And they're broken up, the laws are, in 2 categories. They're broken up, first of all, in what we call the ceremonial laws. Laws having to do with feasts and festivals for the Jews. Laws having to do with the sacrificial system, the temple, and how to go. Laws having to do with the different sacrifices. Laws having to do with dietary regulations and food that can be eaten, right? All of that is made up in the ceremonial law, which was given for them then specifically. Then the second half of the law, and it's not broken out like this, I'm doing it for you, is called the moral law. And this, the moral law, was given for them, and it had to do with things about, laws about servants and how to treat them, laws about personal injuries and how to respond, laws about property, laws about social responsibility. There are laws in Leviticus and Deuteronomy about justice and mercy. In fact, the Ten Commandments fall in the moral category. And so people will talk about, well, don't you Christians, don't you still follow the law, and aren't you supposed to follow the law? Well, the ceremonial law containing all these things that they were supposed to do. That was for them then. Jesus fulfilled the law anyway, didn't he? And so now we continue to follow the moral law. We don't look and say, well, Jesus fulfilled the law, so you know what? All bets are off. Ten commandments, they're off. Go ahead and kill whoever you want, right? That's not how it works. We still follow the moral law. We don't follow the ceremonial law. You know what? And we say, praise God, because hopefully there's some pork and bacon back there on that table after the service, which they were precluded from eating at that time. All of these laws, 613. So when Jesus, go back to the story, when he made eternal life about the commandments, he really only covered 5 of the 10 or 5 of the 613, which is why this man's response was so bombastic and so outlandish. I like those two words, bombastic and outlandish. I mean, think of it. He says, all these, the commandments, all these I have kept since I was a young boy. All of these, or all the laws, all the 5 that Jesus said, or all the law, which is 613. The truth was, nobody could keep all the laws. No one was good enough. But notice, this is important. Jesus doesn't press this point. Jesus doesn't make an issue about his statement, all of these I have kept since I was a youth. Instead, hear this. Jesus allows this man's life and the love of his life to contradict his very assertion. Jesus sets him up. All of these I have kept since my youth. Now Jesus is going to press the point. He could have looked at this guy and said, give me a break, dude. You don't keep all 613 of these laws. I'm relatively certain Jesus could have said, you don't even keep these 5 I just mentioned, and you say you keep. Because we're all sinful, right? We all make mistakes. Sin, we struggle. All of us have a sinful nature, including this rich ruler. But Jesus didn't press that point. Didn't even go there. Instead, look at what he says in verse 22. After the man says, I have kept all of these since I was a young boy, when Jesus heard this, he said to him, you still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And then the biggie, then come, after you've sold all you have and you've given to the poor, then come and follow me. Look at the response in verse 23. When he heard this, he became very what? He became very sad because he was a man of great wealth. And Jesus looked at him and he said, how hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God? Indeed, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. You see, Jesus didn't press his assertion that I've kept all these since I was a young boy. Instead, Jesus goes to the biggest commandment this man couldn't follow, which was the first commandment given in the law that Jesus purposefully omitted. Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, the very first of the 10, it says, you shall have no other gods, little g, before me, right? That's the first commandment ever given. Notice Jesus doesn't quote that one in his original, you know the commandments, do these things. He waits. He allows this man to really see where his heart is. Now, even when that commandment was given by God to Moses, thou shalt have no other gods before me, God himself knows he is the only one true God, right? As we believe and worship God, we believe he's monotheistic. There is one God. We understand the Trinity, but that is the whole idea, concept of one God in three persons. God, when he gave this, he wasn't saying that, you know what, if you look hard enough, you might find some other gods out on the periphery. If you go out into other cultures, you might find other true gods out there. So if you do, resist the desire to worship them. Have no other gods before me. What God is saying here when he says, have no other gods before me, the truth is, folks, he knows that our desire as human beings is to place things above and before God in our life. Now, look at how this plays out for this guy, and then we'll apply. When it came to this rich ruler, what he had, his great wealth, was more important to him than anything else, wasn't it? You say, well, how do you know that? Okay, we don't know it beyond what Jesus says here, but we know obviously his great wealth was more important to him than, first of all, eternal life, right? Because he was very sad when Jesus said, go sell all you have and give to the poor. He could have very easily found some charities in that day. They existed then. He could have very easily taken all of his great wealth, which probably was comprised of a bunch of cattle and animals, maybe some commodities, I don't know. But, well, that is commodities. But he could have taken all of that to the temple. He could have given it to the temple, to the priest there. He could have done that very thing. But obviously, he was very sad, and the Bible connotes that he walked away sad, unwilling to come follow Jesus, because that was more important to him than eternal life. That was more important to him than his God in heaven at this time. And you know, I look at that, he could have responded differently. He asked Jesus maybe an honest question, maybe a loaded question, but he asked nonetheless, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus responds, go sell all you have, give to the poor, after he says, follow the commandments. This man, when he heard Jesus says, go sell all you have, give to the poor, he could have said, okay, that's all it takes? You mean I just got to take what I have and go sell it and give it to the poor, all the proceeds, and then I just got to come follow you? You bet, Jesus, I'm going for it. There's nothing more important to me than my God and my future with my God for eternity. So if that's all it takes, Jesus, I'm going for it. I'm going to do it. But the answer, his answer, not by his words, but by his actions, was not okay, but it was a resounding no. Not doing that. I'm not giving up what I have. I'm not going to come and follow you. And I look and I say, why was it that hard? Why would it have been that hard? Why couldn't he give up? If that's the one thing he was supposed to do, give up what you have and come follow Jesus. If eternal life is on the line, why would he struggle with that? And the answer is this, as you guys are thinking it to yourself, it's because it was a lot of money. And we like our money, right? The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. The truth is, folks, if what you have has become your God, little g, in your life, then it's not an easy thing to give up. It's not an easy thing to depose other gods, little g, in our life. There's a struggle for that throne of our life. There's a struggle for that place of priority in our life. There was a struggle for this man. That's why Jesus says it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to go to heaven. And I've heard people say this before. Well, what Jesus was really saying is the entrance into a sheep pen or to some sort of animal pen was called the eye of a needle, and it was this thing that you would have to duck down low to get in. And so a shepherd would have to duck down low, a camel would have to duck down low. The only problem with that is Jesus was speaking in hyperbole, exaggeration to make a point. He was literally meaning it's impossible if anyone has placed another God on the throne of their life, it's impossible for them to go to heaven, including a rich man. You know what you see here is why they then asked what was in verse 26. Who then can be saved? If that's true, if it's impossible, who then can be saved? Jesus replied in verse 27, what is impossible with men is, what does it say, is what? It's possible with God. Bottom line, it's not impossible for a rich man to get into heaven, but it is impossible for someone who has any other God on the throne of their life to get into heaven. You know what I think, and I'll be honest, this is, thus say I, not the Lord. I personally think Jesus was pressing what he knew to be his idol in his life. And Jesus was pressing his money. And I believe if this man would have looked at Jesus, heard his statement, his comment, and then said, that's all? I'll do it. That's easy. Where do I sign up? I'm going to give it all to this place. I believe if this man would have said, yes, I'll do it, Jesus would have stopped him and he said, you know what? It's okay. I was just checking to see where your heart was. I was just checking to see where your God was. Now, that's my own speculation, but in the end, folks, here is the truth for all of us, and we're going to get to the application. The only way to depose any and all gods in your life, little g, is to place the one true King of Kings and Lord of Lords on the throne of your life. That's the only way that you and I are going to be able to have this battle spiritually and to depose other gods, be it money, or be it, as I'm going to talk about in a second, other things, is by first and foremost deciding to come and follow Jesus. That's why he ends with that. By placing Jesus on the throne of our life. And that's why Jesus says specifically in verse 22, then come, follow me. After you've deposed the god of money in your life, rich ruler, then come follow me. Put me on that throne of that empty throne of your heart. Now put me there because that's where I belong. In fact, it's exactly what the disciples were willing to do when Jesus asked each one of them to come and follow him. And Jesus affirmed that. Peter says, we've left all we had to follow you, verse 28. And Jesus says, I tell you the truth. No one who has left home or wife or brothers or parents or children for the sake of the kingdom of God will fail to receive many times as much in this age and in the age to come eternal life. And Peter's words here are critical when he said to Jesus, we've left all to follow you. Remember when Jesus came to Peter and Paul, or Peter and his brother Andrew? Remember when Jesus came to John and James, these fishermen? What did he say as they're fishing in their business? Come, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. What did they say? They said, you bet. They signed right up. They left it all. They made Jesus the priority. They made him, if we want to say it, the God of their lives, the Lord of their lives. So let's get back as I close to the application. What does this mean for us today? Because God's word applies to us today. Now, I don't know any of your financial situation. I don't know if we have people of great wealth among us. Maybe we do. But here's what it's not only about. This is not only about money. We say love, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. It's also the root of a lot of meals, right? I mean, people want to disparage money, and money is bad, and Christians shouldn't have money. Money is actually how you're going to put food on the table. So as long as money doesn't control you, then it's not the God of your life. There are people who have great wealth that use what they have to glorify God. Are you with me? So what are the other gods, little g, that people have in place? I entitled this sermon, What's Yours? Because maybe it's not great wealth that gets in the way of you following Jesus. Maybe it's something else. Some aren't willing to give things up in order to follow Jesus. Some people won't give up money. I admit that. Some people won't give up the control in their life, to be in charge, to be the one to make the answers. I've got to look to God and trust him, and I've got to pray to him and ask what his will is for my life. I don't want to do that. I like to be in charge. I want to be in control. Some people won't give up the control of their life. Some people won't give up their pride. Some people won't give up their worldly pleasures. Some people won't give up their addictions. Some people won't give up their will. I want to do this with my life. If I give my life to Jesus, then he's going to make me become a missionary in Africa, and I don't want that. You ever heard that one before? Truthfully, that's what I thought. If I become a Christian, one of those crazy Christians, then I'm going to have to go be a missionary someplace where they eat worms, and I don't want to do that. Funny, my wife grew up in Indonesia. She was a missionary. She didn't eat worms. But here's the reality, folks. We have things. Some people won't give up their career. Some people won't give up relationships. For some people, their relationship with a person who's not a Christian is more important. Some people don't give up their addictions. There's a whole host of things beyond just money that we as human beings make the God of our lives. Are you with me? Does that make sense? We place on the throne of our lives. And some of us, having given up our pride here today, giving up our control and our will, some Christians still struggle to put things before God. You know, Christianity is not just following Jesus one time. It's making a continual decision to follow Jesus. Christianity is not just one time in your life getting off the throne and saying, go ahead, Jesus, be the Lord of my life. Now, I did that when I was 20, and I'm sure whenever your salvation moment was, you realized you needed to get off the throne of your life and you need to let Jesus sit on the throne of your life. That's what it means to make him the Lord of our life. And I did that. But doing it one time does not mean that I don't continue to struggle with putting other things in place of God in my life or putting myself back on the throne of my life. Christianity is a continual decision to follow Jesus. It's a continual decision to depose those God's little g in our life. It's a continual struggle that we have in this life with our flesh and a desire to keep the God of all creation, the one true God, on the throne in our lives. To let Jesus stay in that place. You know, I think about Peter who said, we've left all to follow you. Peter, think if he had said to Jesus, you know what, I followed you for a while, but I'm done now. Now I'm going to put my happiness ahead of you. I'm going to put my desire for comfort, my desire to have pleasure, my desire to do what I want in life. I mean, all the different things. Think if Peter had said that. You know, it's precisely why Jesus, what he was driving at a few chapters back, when he said in Luke 14, verse 26, if anyone comes to me and doesn't hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life. Think of the rich ruler. Here as Jesus speaks. He, that person, she, cannot be my disciple follower. And anyone who doesn't carry his cross, which is sacrifice. This guy wasn't willing to sacrifice at all. He says, if anyone doesn't carry his cross and follow me, he cannot be, she cannot be my what? Disciple. That's what Jesus is looking for, men and women, people who want to follow him. And for those of us that want to follow Jesus and make him the Lord of our life, guess what? We don't just do it one time. We keep making Jesus the Lord of our life. Amen? We keep fighting for that throne in our life when our sinful desires rise up, when our flesh rises up, and we're prone to say, yeah, let's go ahead and let pride get back on the throne in our life. Let's go ahead and let our love of money get back on the throne in our life. Let's go ahead and let lust get back on the throne in our life. Let addictions get back on the throne of my life. You know what? I just love that. No, we fight that. We fight it off and we say, Jesus will stay on the throne of my life. Amen? That's what he desires and that's what it means to make him the Lord of our lives. Father, we're thankful for your truth. We're thankful for this simple yet profound story of a man who was unwilling to give up what he had, the most important thing to him. And so, Jesus, today I pray for anybody in this room who maybe for the first time is willing to give up whatever in their life has been more important than you, more important than eternal life with you. In this place today, God, I pray that we all would be willing to give those things, to give them to you, and to allow you to be the Lord for each one of us. Have no other gods before you. And so if we have other gods, little g in our life, little things that your spirit wants to convict us of and show us that we can depose and give to you, I pray you would show us that. I pray that you would give us the strength to do that. For somebody who has made any addiction the Lord of their life, any person the Lord, any passion or pursuit the Lord, God, we depose those things and we choose to make you our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It's in your name we pray these things, and everybody said, amen.